Jigs and Bigs is proud to announce we're being supported by Old Glory Outdoors. They're a veteran-owned company that carries fishing and hunting gear. Plus, they're highly active in supporting veteran organizations and charities. Old Glory is an authorized dealer of Favorite Rods, FX Rods, Guggen Baits, X-Zone Lures, Sixth Sense, and many more. There's a brick-and-mortar store located in East Brookfield, Massachusetts, but you can also order online at oldgloryoutdoors.com. They ship anywhere in the lower 48 states or order online and pick up at the store. When you order, use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS and you'll save 10% off your complete order. Plus, you'll help support the show. Make sure to check out the apparel line called OGO Gear while you're there. Old Glory Outdoors believes in the slogan "Start 'em Young" to keep kids away from screens and enjoying nature. They've got a full array of live bait too. Check out oldgloryoutdoors.com and use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS. Save some money and gear up now. Hey guys, Bobby Roast Beef here. It is an episode of Jigs and Bigs, and we've got ourselves a good one for you. I promise. So this episode here, we got a couple of things. We have another segment with Shaw the Fisherman. We've got a sit down. I got a chance to chit chat a little bit with Bill Rogers from Hookset Hoodlums. They are a angler focused clothing brand, and then some. We talk a little bit about some. We share some stories. We talk a little bit about what it's like fishing in New England. He is a New Englander as well from Connecticut, and I'll let him kind of explain the whole story, guys. Had an amazing weekend. I got to be honest with you. This was so I'm recording this now on Monday afternoon, and on Friday I went out fishing for the first time. That was the end of my quarantine. Test came back for COVID as negative, so we're good to go. My wife was able to go back to work. And Friday, I jumped on it. That was the end of the quarantine for me, and I was able to get out and do some fishing. I fished 4 bodies of water that day, and I got skunked at every single one. It happens. It is what it is. Saturday, I went out, did a little bit more recording. This is after I had recorded the session with Bill. It was a little crazy. I gotta tell you, this weekend in New England was a little bananas overall. On Saturday, I had cut the grass for the first time in 2020. So I'm outside with the lawnmower, you know, doing the lawn, getting everything all, you know, nice and looking good. And right once I'm done, I'm standing on my porch steps looking out, and I'm you know, enjoying a tasty beverage, and I look out and I see snow flurries on what was this? This was, I guess, May 9th. Yeah, on the 9th. That's crazy. It didn't add up to much, but it was just kind of a bizarre moment to have the smell of fresh cut grass. And any New Englanders out there know that, you know, when you can smell snow, yeah, like that. Those two things together should not ever, ever, ever cross over. And it was just weird. So I had gone out that afternoon and fished a little bit as well. 2 different bodies of water. No luck at either one, but I was just excited to be out and doing some stuff. And then Sunday, I had... So Sunday and today were very interesting. Sunday I had it's Mother's Day, of course. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. So Sunday was Mother's Day, and we had gone and dropped off some flowers and some gifts at my mother-in-law's and my mother's house because we weren't able to get together and do our Mother's Day celebrating or anything like that. And my wife had made some arrangements to gather at a social distancing, responsible gathering of the dance moms of the dance studio where she is at a local winery. Now, it was very, very strict rules with like seating chart and everything else, but she wanted to go and have herself a good time. And I mean, it's been now, 2 months that life for most people has just been completely in upheaval. So I made the offer. I said, look, I don't want you to go and, you know, have a couple glasses of wine and feel like you can't indulge. cold. So I said, I'll tell you what, I will bring you to the winery and I'll find a local spot nearby to fish for a couple of hours. And whenever you're ready, I will come home and or I'll head back over, pick you up. And that way you can get home safely. Being the caring and thoughtful husband that I am. So it worked out really well. But here's where she had a great time, which is excellent. End of the day, that's really all that matters. She had an excellent time and got to congregate in a social distancing fashion in a responsible way. So she was able to kind of like hang out with her girlfriends and have some fun. It was good. I'm happy for her. Now, with that said, what did I do with my couple hours? I had a little bit of an adventure. I used the Fishbrain app and I was looking around at the closest areas to where she was at so I could go and try and fish. And I found this little pond, not so little pond. I would say it was a decent sized pond, probably about maybe half a dozen acres or so. Nothing crazy, but you know, I'm decent size. So I decide I'm going to go and check this out. There was an area right up against the road. I was able to pull off the side of the road and jump over, and I didn't see any signs anywhere at the time when I moved over, when I climbed over to do some fishing. But I get over there and I'm fishing, and it's absolutely gorgeous. There was a little dam on one end, and I was just kind of working this one bank, this straight bank. And I was throwing a few different things. I was throwing a spinnerbait. I was throwing I threw a Ned rig, and I threw a black and blue flipping jig quite a bit. And that was just that's what they wanted. And it was kind of odd. It was a weird kind of jig bite where it was very non-committal, you know, peckish almost. And I was just like, this is kind of crazy. So that's why I started throwing the Ned. They didn't want anything to do with the Ned. So I go, okay, we're going to keep going with the jig. And I kept throwing it. Well, eventually it got picked up. I saw the line start moving on me. I set the hook. I caught the biggest perch of my life, the biggest yellow perch of my life. I wish I would have gotten a picture, but I took my scale to weigh it. And as I was weighing it, I went to go take it off the scale, and it slipped off. I was standing on a hill, but just dropped right into the water, and he swam off. I got him on the scale. It was just under a pound. I typically don't catch yellow perch that size. This was a monster. Definitely not something I would ever expect to catch on a flipping jig at all. Because this thing was, I just didn't think it had the hardware for it. That was kind of blew me away. But yeah, it definitely worked. So anyway, I didn't catch anything else beyond that. That was actually after I caught that guy. That was about the time I had to go back and pick up the wife. So I got a little bit of time out on Sunday. That was great. Couple hours, no big. Got home and called it a night. Well, today I had a bunch of errands I needed to run, and I knew we were expecting some rain, but I wanted to get out and beat the rain. So I went over to this little lake nearby me, and this is a great lake when I want to put on some miles and I want to do some walking, because there's a lot of bank to cover and a whole you don't get bored easily, which is really nice. So I go and I'm doing my routine over there. I'm fishing all the laydowns, and I'm throwing that black and blue jig, and I'm throwing a couple other things too. I'm throwing working a spinnerbait a little bit to try to see what's out there, trying to nail them down. And I get over to this one spot where there's a couple relatively new laydowns. And there's this this channel that kind of connects to this back, like a back pond almost, a back cove. It's a very odd setup, but I'm working along this entire channel, and I get to the end where it opens up to that back cut. I'm working a laydown that's down there right next to this one brand new laydown, and my jig got annihilated. And this wasn't a beast of a fish at all. It was just under 2 pounds. Good fish. Biggest fish I've ever caught from this one body of water. This one specific pond has a ton of pressure. And in fact, there's a side of it where you can't access it unless you do so by kayak and you go under a bridge because it's private property on that side. So it was a little bit of a challenge. knowing actually that the other side is the better fishing spot is definitely something that irritates me quite a bit. I gotta get a look into a kayak. Anyway, caught this guy. It was pouring rain. I mean, just absolute validation. It was wonderful. Got a good release on him, and then came back in, and here I am recording the intro for this. So it was really good. I'll tell you, after 2 weeks of essentially not leaving the house at all, It's, man, it was so nice to get outside, get to the water, catch a couple of fish, and just have a good time. Even going out and getting skunked. Like I always say this, I would rather go out and take a shot and try and catch some fish and get skunked. At the end of the day, I put the work in, you know, and it's like there's a reward in that, just making the effort. And it makes these other catches that much better because, you know, I had to kind of hustle to make it happen. So it was really cool. Anyway, guys, we're going to jump in. We're going to do, we're going to switch things up. I'm going to do the Shaw the Fisherman segment after we hear from Bill Rogers. Guys, check out Hookset Hoodlums. They've got some new gear that's on the website. Check them out on Instagram. Absolutely. They're amazing. You know, they have some good stuff coming out. They actually just released two brand new t-shirt designs. One of them's really cool. It's like a Pabst Blue Ribbon can mock-up. It's pretty cool. Check out Hookset Hoodlums, guys. There's going to be more stuff going on. We mentioned in there the idea of like collaborating on something, maybe organizing some kind of a tournament or something. We'll see what happens. I expect to hear more from Bill because we're definitely going to have Bill and more of the Hookset Hoodlums crew making an appearance on this show. So we'll sit in with them, and then we're going to finish things off with Shaw the Fisherman. Guys, have yourself a great week. Why don't you start out, Bill, by telling me the story about how you kind of came up into fishing, and feel free, you can add if you want some of like your favorite things.
Okay.
And you know, any like, well, actually we'll get to some fishing stories in a bit. Just go ahead and start there.
Yeah. So I came up, obviously I'm born and raised in Connecticut. And my grandparents lived up north in Lincoln, Maine. So the summers I would spend about 3 months a year actually up there. And they lived right on a lake on Mattanoaka Pond. And that is where I would fish. The moment I woke up, I'd get out there and start fishing. Mm-hmm. And as I got older and I'd go back year after year, I would, you know, explore more and more of the town. That's the home of 13 lakes. I would fish every place I could, every place I was allowed, and every place I wasn't allowed to. And I've been fishing ever since, just hooked from a early age, you know. And I primarily bass fished up there, this smallmouth bass, but I'd go up farther up north to Caribou. My uncle Ed lived out there. Mm-hmm. And that's where I learned like the other half, like bass is like more sport fishing to me and just having fun, catch and release. And he would fish, you know, for dinner out there, you know, catching trout in small streams. And that's what you're eating. So yep. I got to see both sides of it. And, you know, I fell in love with fishing right away. So
that's crazy. I didn't realize how far up north Lincoln was. I didn't realize it was north of Bangor. I had no idea.
I remember it's a long 7.5 hours, yeah. Unless my uncle Mike was driving, and then maybe five.
Yeah, that's crazy, man.
Yeah.
So why don't you tell me a little bit about like your favorite season for fishing, what you look forward to each year, and also like what you definitely don't necessarily could do less with, you know?
Okay. So right now, because I don't, to start it off, I actually don't typically ice fish. I'll go out, you know, periodically every couple of years, I'll go out maybe once. It's not my thing. The cold's not my thing. That's when I'm setting up my gear, praying for March to come. But so with that being said, I can't wait for this time of year where we start getting hints of warm weather.
Yeah.
But although I see people catching, you know, monsters around here somehow in early May, it's typically never my it's never my lucky season. But right around June, July, that water's warm and calm. I love throwing soft plastics. That's when I get my best fish, July, early August.
What's your go-to soft plastic? Like your preferred style?
I'll use a variety of things, especially the last couple of years. But obviously, I think a rubber worm, a Senko is my go-to where, you know, I think that's the first, probably the first soft plastic I use where I'm successful, like repeatedly. So mm-hmm. I think you kind of stick to what you know. However, you know, I have been the last couple of years using the little rattling Neds and
love those lures.
Yeah. I mean, dude, they catch everything.
Yeah. I mean, I caught a 4-pounder on a little Ned rig, and I love, it's so innovative that they threw the rattle in there.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's, I love that product. I think they did a really good job with it. I really like, the way that the, what is it? The Z-Man, what do you call that? This they're soft plastic, the Elastec.
Okay. Yeah.
I love how buoyant it is, but it's so difficult to rig and have it, you know, be like perfectly straight. It just, it takes a little bit more finesse. I could only imagine if you were to throw a rattle, and I'm sure we're going to see it coming at some point.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
In one of those. Oh my God. I love that rattle and Ned.
Yeah. The thing about the rattle and Ned, sticking just to Googan baits for a second, I was using that, that Bandito bug, you know, and I loved it and I was cleaning up on it. And then I never had a problem, even smaller fish I'm catching on that thing, because typically people say it's a little clunky and stuff like that. But then when I started using the rattle and Ned, even though I know the Bandito I'm successful with, I have a hard time switching out of the rattle and Ned and going to anything else as far as that stuff goes. So I have about 10 packs of Banditos in my bag, and I'm still constantly just using the rattle and Ned. So that's pretty much been my go-to lately. Probably last year or so.
They have a color that I can't get enough of. I think it's called Black Flash.
Black Flash, and the I think that's so. And I like the PB&J also.
Just picked up some PB&J to give a try. That one in Canada, it was Black Flash and Canada Craw that worked really, really well for me. But there's just something about it's that Black Flash, just it catches their eye. I don't know what it is. The glitter is just super bright.
Oh yeah. And, they use a lot of good I wonder if it's the salt or what. I mean, people hate on that brand for whatever reason, but I mean they make really good baits. You can't if you use them, I think you're a believer. You know, people complain they tear and stuff like that, but that's how they're made. They're made they move around more, they're a little softer, more salt, so you're going to be successful, but you're going to go through more.
And soft plastics just tear. I mean, if you want soft plastics that aren't going to tear, you switch over to the Elastec stuff, and I mean that stuff will last. But at the same time, it's also difficult because you can't really store it just any which way.
Sure. Sure. Well, how about the Yamamoto? I mean, people have been using that forever, that's always still the complaint, is that they tear. But they work, so who cares?
Yeah, they definitely work. Yeah, it's crazy. Like the whole, everybody's got a stick bait out there, and you know, it gets down to confidence. You know, I love the Yamamotos. I'm probably always going to buy that brand when it comes to using Senkos, but you know, for other stuff, there's certain creature baits. For the longest time, I was just all about the coffee scent with the Rage stuff.
Hell yeah.
Man.
Hey, and they work. Absolutely. And
they do. Absolutely. I mean, that's part of the reason why I've got so many soft plastics, is it's just like, you know, you find something that works, or, you know, you end up discovering a lot of times, at least I do, where I'll be looking for a certain style, but the color that I'm looking for isn't necessarily there. So I might find a similar color and a similar style in another brand. And it's like, I mean, they're all plastic. They're not meant to last forever. People blast jigs out, you know, off left and right and say, oh, well, you're not fishing a jig if you're not losing them. I mean, when you break down the cost per soft plastic, it's, if it wears out after a couple of fishes, I'm not going to complain.
Yeah, me either. You know, me either. Like I said, if I'm hooking up it, then that's all I wanted to do anyway. So I'm fine with it.
The one thing that blows that irritates me, and it's not a Googan thing necessarily, because there's lots of other companies to do this, but I'm not a fan of that plastic clamshell that holds them together. Like for in the store, I feel like it makes perfect sense, you know, to keep everything nice and organized and everything, and that's fine. Like if you're storing them, I get that. But as soon as they go into my backpack, I take them all out, I put them right in the pouch, zip them up, so that way they can at least move a little bit more.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, they're just sitting there. Plus, you know, they're falling on top of each other and stuff like that, and then it's closed up. But yeah, no, that's a good point. Oh, yeah. You're right.
And, I had a friend of mine say, like, yeah, but what about when it's like 80, 90 degrees and you leave it in your truck? And I was like, that's why I don't leave my fishing stuff in my truck. Try to keep it cool and dry as much as I can, but yeah, that's I'm a big fan of their line of soft plastics though.
Me too. Yeah. Yeah.
No, it's definitely good stuff. So the popular question, and it was never intended to be that per se, but this next question has to do with fishing lure trends. So what's the fishing trend or specific lure from, in your opinion, that like throughout history that was just the stupidest thing you've ever seen, but the one thing that you were like, you know, or have you been guilty of trying it, I should say?
Okay, so I know that several people on the show have already said it. And the first time I heard you ask this question, it popped into my head immediately before the guy answered. But I don't know if it's the stupidest, but definitely the biggest shtick like for bait was the Banjo Minnow. Yeah. That thing, like I said, they advertised so well. They did such a good marketing job on that, on every infomercial. That's all. I mean, it's all I remember. I've used it. And as great, it's like a cheap little thing that they sold so well. And I would use it again today if I could find it, because it just nostalgia. But everybody felt for the Banjo Minnow.
Oh yeah, when that was sort of the big push, was they had an infomercial, and I used to work in television. And this was like the very late 90s, early 2000s. I can remember having to run that infomercial on either before or after, The Outdoorsman with Buck McNeely. I don't know if you remember that show, but I can remember they would schedule it right beforehand. Go like, no, we need this to run before The Outdoorsman runs. Or afterwards. And yeah, I mean, I was just like, TV infomercials, a 30-minute commercial for the Banjo Minnow. And at this point, I wasn't doing much fishing at all. And I'm just like, who's going to buy that? And I was amazed. Like, people really did buy it. And some people swear by it. They say that it actually does work. But it you know, I mean, you're talking about pieces of plastic and wire. Yeah, it can all catch fish.
Yeah, right. Of course. Yeah. Well, I think you said it best. It's like, it's the confidence of what you're throwing. Yep. If you're in a shitty mood and you go out there and you're like pressed for time and you know you're probably not catching fish. If you're like, this is the Banjo Minnow, I catch everything on this, you know, somehow you're going to end up hooking up probably with a Banjo Minnow.
It's crazy, man. So tell me a little bit about Hookset Hoodlums, like the direction where you guys are going, how it all kind of came together, and what essentially embodies Hookset Hoodlums.
Okay, thank you for asking. Hookset Hoodlums is, right now it's an apparel company that we started. So my buddy Ken introduced me to, who's now one of my good friends, Andrew Tomer. And he said, hey, this guy fishes as much as you do, you know, because obviously, we're obsessed. This is what we do. So, and you know, when somebody says that, when you're a fisherman, everybody you meet, oh yeah, I fish too. Yeah, sure you do. Yeah. But this guy had matched my obsessiveness for fishing for sure. We went out. We had a good time. You know, we caught some fish, a lot of laughs, which is, you know, that's all you could ask for. So
yeah,
we became fishing buddies. The three of us had a little text group going. One day I threw the name up on the top of the text thread, Hookset Hoodlums, just something I thought of. And then it evolved into, you know, we made shirts, you know, just goofing around. And I'm a consumer, you know, I buy fishing stuff all the time, from apparel to baits to the Banjo Minnows. And we had some Hookset Hoodlums shirts made just for, I think, the three of us at the time. And we started talking. I said, man, everywhere I go, I'm dropping my kids off at school, I'm doing this, I'm at the store, people are asking me, what's Hookset Hoodlums? I never hear that about anything else I wear. I think the name is just, it's catchy. It stands out. So people get a little bit interested.
Yeah.
And they had similar, you know, expressed similar things. So yeah. People are asking me, people are talking, hey, we should make a quick run of shirts just for, you know, for our friends or whatever, if they're interested. Wasn't a big, like, a profit thing. It still isn't right now. It's the same as anything. It's like, it's just, we make a bunch of stuff now. We have hoodies, you know, long sleeve tees, t-shirts, stickers, a whole bunch of cool stickers and stuff. And it's the same as the podcast, the same as a forum. It's not some giant company. It's us just making stuff, like a fishing community, common interest, just people basically that are obsessed with that lifestyle. So everything we bring in, we kind of put back into it, and new designs and stuff like that. And it has blown up recently, and I'm grateful for that. But realistically, it's just why buy other people's stuff when I could wear my own? So I love it. We have a YouTube channel coming out. We're in the process of doing some stuff like that. We have a couple other things in the works, and that's what it is. Hooksethoodlums.com. It's clothes. It's whatever. It's a fishing community.
Yeah. That's awesome though. And actually, as you were saying that, it got me thinking. I'm like, that's kind of one of the things that I really like, is when you kind of, like, one of the backgrounds I came from was like playing local music in the area. Like it was like another life ago, but you would have these little scenes of people that would work together, and it was a community, you know? And so if you were playing in a band or you were play shows at a specific place, you know, you would have that, you know, that sticker or that hat or shirt or something. And then, like, you know, you would just meet people and you could kind of connect the dots that way, you know, in sort of like within a community. So like, I like, you know, representing an organization, a brand, something that's from my area, especially when it comes to like fishing specifically, where different areas, you know, you say New England, that's a whole other style of fishing than, you know, on the West Coast down, you know, Southern California or Florida or Texas. You know, it's a whole other animal. So it's pretty cool. And I'm like, I could definitely see where people would get behind, you know, supporting a brand that's from their region. And they're just like, oh, yeah, well, I have something in common with these people. You know, yeah.
Absolutely. I think that's a big thing about your podcast. It's just recently caught my attention. And I was I think I told you this online or something. But I know somebody wrote it in one of the reviews. Dude, it's like I listen to podcasts all the time. I always have an earbud in, you know, but half the time my wife is talking, I'm just nodding and listening to a podcast.
We're all guilty.
I listen to, you know, fishing, outdoors podcasts. I live, sleep, and breathe it. And kind of as you're saying, we're not fishing, you know, Florida. We're not fishing Okeechobee and California getting 10-pound bass. And we're not going for steelheads in the rivers. I mean, we have a totally different way of fishing. We're fishing ponds, you know, for me, for bass anyway, for bass fishing, I'm talking about. We're fishing small ponds and lakes and soft plastics and a totally different style, a totally different culture. And East Coast fishing is for sure its own entity. And that's why I love this podcast, because it's like so much more relatable to our style, you know.
If you can relate that, I think that right there, you've immediately, you know, you've already won in a way, because if you get people that can relate to what you have going on, it's just, you know, it's a home run. Now, that was part of the reason with this podcast that I was a little bit weary of even starting it, was because I know that podcasting is a global form of you know, dispersing information or entertainment. So I'm like, if I'm talking about fishing stories with, you know, my buddies and my circle of friends, is that really going to land elsewhere? But really what I found is that, so there's listeners I've found all over the place, that are listening to the show, and they're giving some feedback, because, you know, and even, you know, some people that are just on our sort of, not necessarily directly in our area for New England per se, but somebody who's maybe in the Northern Midwest that maybe has seasons that are similar to what we have, a shortened grow season for bass. They have ice for, you know, 3-4 months of the year. They can kind of, you know, understand what it is that we're working with, and it sort of like kind of brings people together. I think that's pretty awesome.
Oh yeah. I mean, I'm listening to Meat Eater talk about elk hunting that's something I don't do. It's something I probably will never get the chance to do, but when they start touching upon steelheads or salmon fish, it's whatever, it's the culture, it's the lifestyle. So it's funny. I mean, I'm listening to that, and that's not my life, but I enjoy it. It's entertaining.
Yep.
So I can see why, you know, this, if you're a fisherman, this is what what we do when we're not fishing now.
Oh, absolutely. So, all right, now I'm trying to push more for a sort of go in the direction of sharing, like, ultimately, ideally, two epic stories. So give me a story about, like, your biggest, like, the catch that you're most proud of. All right, like the one that you're just like, yeah, this is it. Maybe it's your PB, maybe it's not, maybe it's, you know, something that has an interesting story of how you landed it or something. And then share with me your most epic fail while fishing.
Okay. I'll just go recent. I think you know, there's a whole bunch of fish that are you know, maybe not the biggest, that are, you know, more important stories based on who I was with or things like that. So I'll just go last year towards the end of the year. So I got the kayak out. I'm in a small lake that I fish all the time. So weedy. I never throw cranks or anything like that. And by the way, I'll fish with cranks all the time now. And I still feel like I'm letting myself down because I'm a soft plastics guy. But so I'm throwing a crank along right in front of a bed of lily pads. And as soon as I'm right at the kayak, my rod rips out of my hand. I mean, not completely out of my hand. I set the hook, which you don't have to do as much with a crank. And, this thing starts going, that my drag's pulling.
Oh, okay.
I was just, you know, unprepared basically, I think, because I was just about to bring it in. And, I see the mouth. I see the, you know, you see that white under the water. Like, okay, this is a good fish.
Oh, absolutely. That's the tell all right there.
Oh yeah. So I know it's trying to jump. So I put my pole back down into the water. I bring it up close. I see the mouth open, and it's like, it was like just you grab it. I grab the mouth as it's about to jump and rip it into the kayak. It was about little, probably right over four. And so it wasn't the biggest fish, but it was a great largemouth bass. Yeah. And pulled it in at the end of the season. And that was probably, as far as recently, probably my best fish, you know, like just like a Hail Mary shot, you know?
Yep. That's awesome, man. That's a good freaking story. And you're right. Like when that fish goes broadside and you get that flash of the white belly, you have real good understanding of what it is on the other line. That's when you get really excited. You're like, whoa, this could be a whole other animal. And it's cool because when you're not fishing, it's those moments where you start to sort of like plant the seeds to build confidence in another bait or another presentation.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Like that's the real win. It's not even so much like, I mean, a 4-pound fish is that's a good story for years and years to come. But on top, like what you've gotten out of that now to, if you build on it, who knows what can happen, you know?
It's right. Just it's not even, beginning. It wasn't even a PB. It's just, you know, the experience, like you said, you're learning, you're throwing something you're not comfortable with. It's windy. I'm like going in, I'm like, yeah, I'm done for the day. And then those are the good ones, you know?
What is your PB?
I don't have, an accurate measure. I'll call it five. I'll call it five.
Yeah.
But, I think it was a little over. I'm just doing that to be safe. So I'll call it five.
I'm the same way. I had caught what I believe would have been my personal best, but I've got like that imaginary number where if I go over that, I'm going to take measurements to do a replica. I'm like, this way I kind of have, so now I've got something where I can kind of mark it and it's fair. I think I actually shared that story in one of the episodes.
I remember you saying you had a spot on the wall ready. And it's so funny. I had to laugh at that because every time we go out, we're like, all right, today's the mount. Today's the day we're getting the mount. Because we all have these spots. We all have these plans the fish we're going to get on the wall replicated.
It is freaking bananas. Now, what about like your biggest epic fail? Like where you either, maybe you lost a fish, maybe you hooked an angler, like with something along those lines.
All right, this was a little psychotic. It's a funny story.
No, psychotic is good.
Yeah,
some of our listeners, Shaw the Fisherman will appreciate it.
Is that the guy who fishes next to the porn house?
Yes, the porn house guy.
So when I was growing up in the summers in Maine, in Lincoln, my grandmother, but by the way, influenced for sure by a lot of family members that fished.
Yeah.
But, you know, they say your father, your grandfather, uncles, whatever, which by the way, my grandfather and uncle, all big fishermen. I would say the person who got me hooked on fishing was my grandmother because she was the one that put up with my ass. She's a little more patient. She'd be out there every day fishing with me, you know, show me how to clean the fish that they were eating, you know, the perch and stuff like that.
Yep.
And she for sure showed me the way. But okay, so she has this, like every lake, you know, Loch Ness monster in her lake. She's saying there's an 8-pound smallmouth called Big Boy. And she fished, she's had it on once or twice and it broke her off. This is Maine, you know, 8-pound smallmouth anywhere is humongous, but 8-pound smallmouth in Lincoln. And my uncle Ed had it and it broke his line and it snapped the pole on Uncle Vernon and, you know, all this stuff. It's just, you know, fairy tale stuff. So, I'm fishing a dock and a boat launch within eyesight of the, my grandparents' house.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm with this kid and I haven't talked to him in years. I've tried to look him up. He's somewhere. And if, by the way, if he's still in New England, maybe he'll hear this. Chris Handy. So Chris Handy is fishing with me. We're like 13 years old. I think I was just using a night crawler. I hook up. I know it's a giant. It's absolutely going to be my biggest fish at the time, which we, you know, only 13, but we caught fish all the time. We lived on the lake. So I got this monster. It's running. I could see it's by far the biggest fish I ever would have had. Now, 8 pounds, of course not. But I'm saying it's a big boy, right? So I'm yelling as I'm reeling it in because I see my grandmother outside the yard. I'm like, I got big boy on. Chris Handy grabs the line to pull it up about 3 feet away from the hook for some reason. No. I watch the hook rip out of this smallmouth's mouth, rip the lip. The fish turns in the air. It still had time to hit the water, and it was gone.
Oh,
so Chris Handy,
my God.
Wherever you are, you're an asshole.
Oh man, that is freaking bananas.
I think I still think to this day, and again, it's funny because as time goes on, you have this number in your head or this picture of your head. But yeah. To this day, that still might have been the biggest fish I would have ever caught.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it's you're like, it's you'll wrestle with that forever. You're like, you know, I'll never really know, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, man, that is absolutely freaking bananas. Wow. To be like so close. Oh
yeah, it was there. God. And I don't even know why you grabbed the line. I had it. It's just, yeah. I've lost plenty of big fish. That's just a funny little story.
I love smallies. There is just, I don't catch them enough. And I definitely don't go out and necessarily target smallies per se. But I recently caught a 2.5 pounder. And
that's a great fish.
I was blown away with it. I was like, and I mean, I was more impressed with the fact I was like, oh, I got a smallie. Look at this.
Dude, especially when you're not used to catching them. They look so cool. The color's great.
And they
they
fight so unbelievably hard. And that's one of my goals, a short-term goal is to, like, I mean, you're a Connecticut guy. The Connecticut mm-hmm. River has a fantastic resource in our area. You go up and down the Connecticut River Valley, and it is fantastic. But as a bank angler, I don't even have hair to pull out anymore, but I would. It's so, so hard to fish the river effectively as a bank angler. So my goal right now is, and there's a boat in play, but I want to really break down the Connecticut River. You know, I'm up in Holyoke where we got the dam. So a lot of times we just refer to north or south of the dam, but both sides, I just want to work the hell out of that thing.
You mentioned the Connecticut River. That's the only place I don't even target them because it's so much of a headache, but, for where I'm at, but I mean, people catch them. You see in these forums, like a monster size. But when I'm catfishing, sometimes the Connecticut River, that's when, that's the only time I'm really pulling them up, and nothing big, nothing. I haven't even hit, you said 2.5, but that's a great smallmouth. I haven't gotten that. Just catch them by chance on, while catfishing.
Yeah, that is, and it's funny that you say that too, because the first time I ever caught a smallie, it was the same sort of idea. I was just catfishing along the river. I was just below the dam, and I had it was maybe like a 1.5 pounder. I mean, not a big smallie at all.
Yeah,
but I couldn't believe I was like, oh, that's right. I was like, there's smallies in the river. That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's actually another Connecticut angler. I think her name is Andrea, the blonde angler.
Dude, I was just going to say that chick, I feel like her smallmouth pictures taught me.
Her
largemouth pictures taught me too.
Yeah. But I mean, she has some pictures of specific, like I'll see smallies come up in my feed and I'm just like, damn. And
I'm going to block her soon.
she's too damn good. Yeah. Oh, it's freaking bananas. Yeah, it really is. That I think has to be like on my radar for every year I try to have something going, and COVID has messed this year up.
Oh yeah. So by the way, how are you guys doing? I heard that you had a little scare over there.
We're doing okay. I mean, we had 2 weeks that we were in quarantine, so it was 2 weeks of no fishing, 2 weeks of just the same four people in the house.
Oh yeah.
We quarantined the kids. They basically ran the roost upstairs. We stayed downstairs. They didn't get it at all. Both my wife and I had it, but my my wife had to get retested so she could go back to work, and she got a negative test yesterday. So we're good.
Oh wow, good.
We're not showing any symptoms. I went fishing yesterday, and now it's game on. Now I just get back into the groove. Although I did fish four spots yesterday and got skunked at all of them. So I'm thinking that today is going to be the day. We'll see.
Today's the day.
Today's the day. Awesome, man. Well, this is really good, Bill. This is really, really awesome. Thanks for doing this.
No, thanks for having me, man. Like I said, I checked it out. As soon as I saw the thing, I listened to an episode while I was working. I was like, I told my buddy Andrew, I said, dude, you got to check this out. This is like, I mean, you're not hearing podcasts where people talking about bank fishing. That's what we do. You know, we're just fishing by any means. I love it.
I am. I'm throwing around the idea of organizing a bank fishing tournament. Just like as like a collab. So if you guys want to get in on it, I think it would be awesome. You know, we'll just get together and do something with like Tourney X or something, have people. I got to look into kind of how to make it work, but more like just for fun. I don't know if I'd necessarily do anything crazy for prizes or anything like that. I probably would make a really cheap buy-in, but it'd be a lot of fun.
Don't I'm going to tell you this. I don't know if you've seen anyone who's listening, at hookset.hoodlums, but at reeling.in.life. We did a three-man, just the three of us.
Yep.
We're going to end it October 15th or November 1st for the bass season. So this guy had, Andrew had a title made, a championship belt.
Oh, you guys do the belt. I forgot dude, about the belt.
It has ruined bass fishing for me because it's just the heaviest fish. Whoever holds the current heaviest fish out of the three of us will have the belt. And then when October 15th or November 1st, when it's up, that's who has the belt. And we'll take a buckle or keep the belt at your house, whatever. But now I can't even enjoy it. I'm like aggressively fishing. The I'm throwing 100 miles out. Oh, dude. And I'm like, it's May. I can't be living like this. This is too much anxiety. I'm supposed to be relaxing. So tournaments are fun. But if you have this guy in it, he can't win. He's disqualified because he's a cyber bully.
That's awesome. Oh, I think that is freaking awesome. Yeah,
it is. It makes it fun, you know.
It's funny. It's funny that you mentioned the belt because I remember going through the Instagram and I came across it and I was like, wait a minute. I was like, that's a good idea. So one of my venues where I host trivia in Northampton, there was a team who was just like, we love this. We're going to be doing this all summer long. Every single week we'll be here. And one of them put together a title belt for trivia. It was, you know, just like one of the stretchy fabric toys with the plastic inserts. And they had gone and redone with like stencils and wording. Yeah. So it said like trivia champion. I have it actually in my office somewhere because it's been so long since I've been able to host. But people lose their minds for little like titles like that. They really do. And I saw that. I was like, nope, I dig what these guys are doing. This is awesome. That's what we do.
Just bullshit and have fun, you know?
I love it, man. Awesome. Well, hey, thanks, Bill. This is really good. I'm going to edit this down and get things together. If you want, take a minute and go ahead and plug Hookset Hoodlums, plug what you guys have going on.
Okay, great. Yeah, thank you very much for having me. So, if anyone's interested, it's hooksethoodlums.com. And it's an apparel company. Like I said, we have t-shirts, long sleeve t-shirts, hoodies, stickers, hats, flex fit, all that stuff.
Yep.
Check it out. A bunch of cool stuff. But, you know, follow us on Instagram at hookset.hoodlums, at reeling.in.life, at underwater robberies, and myself at Wild Bill Fishing. And, it's nothing crazy. We're just having fun. It's a community and just having fun being a part of it. And social media has really brought it all together, especially now, you know.
Oh, yeah, 100%. Are you guys restocking the camo hats?
Yeah, actually, we just placed an order yesterday. I just got off the phone with the distributor yesterday because we wanted to switch to get some snapback options with the mesh back. So, those are on the way. And, camo. And we got two new designs, which I think for sure summer New England style t-shirts. So those are going to drop, I think, today or tomorrow. So keep an eye out for those. I think everyone's going to dig those.
Very nice, man. That's awesome. Well, thanks a lot, Bill. I'm going to work on this tournament. We should definitely do some team stuff.
Absolutely.
I think it'd be so cool. Awesome. Well, you have a good one. Tight lines, and we'll see you later.
Yes, sir. Tight lines. Thank you very much.
All right. Take care, bud.
All right.
Sean. Sean. Sean.
Hey, this is Shaw the Fisherman with my weekly story. I want to talk about a cool night we had. It was literally cool. It was cold. Talk about the day we had fishing. Me and my high school buddies had gone out to Lake Out East on a campground. There was a storm incoming that night. And during the afternoon, we went out fishing. Wind was blowing. Perfect conditions for big bass to hit. And luckily, one of my buddies hit I think it was 6 pounds or more, largemouth, great fish. We went back. We had dinner. The storm started creeping in. It hit, it washed through, we got dumped on, and then the frontal conditions were sitting on top of us afterwards for the night. So two or three of us went out night fishing at the same lake, and the bite was slow. I think altogether three of us caught maybe two fish, tiny ones. But the memorable part of the evening was there were cottages on this lake, and there was a rather intoxicated and getting more intoxicated as evening went on gentleman sitting on his beach in a lawn chair with a cooler, and his house speakers pointed at the lake. And at that point, I, for whatever reason, had not listened to the Tool Anima CD for years. He let it play in its entirety with all the bonus tracks. And while there was nothing really crazy about that night, we had a good soundtrack to it. Thanks. See you next week.
That was a pretty good show, guys. Thank you so much, everybody, for listening in. Just want to mention one more time, thanks so much for our guests. Thanks to Bill Rogers. Thanks, of course, to Shaw the Fisherman for his 2 cents. Also, thank you for listening and checking this out. And also, the feedback and the commentary coming back from everybody is really, really fantastic. Love the reviews. If you haven't reviewed us yet, you can subscribe to us on Spotify, subscribe on Apple Podcasts. If you like the show, this way you'll get notifications when a new episode drops. I'm not the most organized podcaster. I like to stick to a kind of a routine, but I don't put anything out there in stone. So do yourself a favor. If you're using Apple Podcasts, if you're using Spotify, use the subscribe feature. So when a new episode drops, you'll get a notification right away. And remember, I mean, this show is free to listen to and free to enjoy. If you know an angler, if there's an angler in your life that you think might enjoy this, and whether they're from New England or not, go ahead and share this information on social media with them, how they can listen to Jigs and Bigs, and you'd be doing me a solid. Absolutely. Also, follow me on Instagram specifically. We've been doing a whole lot with Instagram, and I'm going to be working on a few things in the future regarding giveaways, really. That's one of the things that we want to do, is run some kind of a contest for our listeners, and it's going to cross over both with Instagram and with the podcast format. So if you could do me a solid and invite your friends and share our stuff on Instagram, on your live feed, or on your timeline. Join us over on Facebook too. We have a really active Facebook page as well. Thanks so much, everybody. I really appreciate you for listening. You guys are absolutely awesome, and we'll be back with the next episode in a week.